The Complete Works of Swami Vekananda, Vedanta and Its Application to Indian Life, Part 6. Endless examples can be cited, but we have no time in this lecture to do or to show the marvelous poetry of the Upanishads, the painting of the sublime, the grand conceptions. But one other idea I must note, that the language and the thought of and everything that come direct, they fall upon you like a blade sword. Strong as blows of a hammer they come. There is no mistaking their meanings. Every tone of that music is firm and produces its full effect. No gyrations, no mad words, no intricacies in which the brain is lost. No signs of degradation are there. No attempts are too much allegorizing. Too much piling of adjectives after adjectives, making it more and more intricate till the whole of the sense is lost and the brain becomes giddy and the man does not know his way out from the maze of that literature. There was none of that yet. If it were to be human literature, it must be the production of a race which had not yet lost any of its national vigor. Strength. Strength is what the Upanishads speak to me from every page. This is the one great thing to remember. It has been the one great lesson I have been taught in my life. Strength. It says, strength, O man, be not weak. Are there no human weaknesses? Says man. There are, says the Upanishads. But will more weaknesses heal them? Would you try to wash dirt with dirt? Will sin cure sin? Weakness cure weakness? It is strength, O man, strength, say the Upanishads, stand up and be strong. Aye, it is the only literature in the world where you find the word abhi, fearless, used again and again. In no other scripture in the world in this adjective applied either to God or to man. Abhi, fearless. And in my mind rises from the past the vision of the great emperor of the West, Alexander the Great. And I see, as it were in a picture, the great monarch standing on the banks of the Indus, talking to one of our sannyasis in the forest. The old man he was talking to, perhaps naked, stark naked, sitting upon a black stone. And the emperor, astonished at his wisdom, tempting him with gold and honor to come over to Greece. And this man smiles at his gold and smiles at his temptations and refuses. And then the emperor, standing on his authority as an emperor, says, I will kill you if you do not come. And the man bursts into laughter and says, you never told such a falsehood in your life as you tell just now. Who can kill me? Me you killed, emperor of the material world, never. For I am spirit unborn and undecaying. Never was I born and never do I die. I am the infinite, the omnipresent, the omniscient. And you kill me, child that you are. That is strength. That is strength. And the more I read the Upanishads, my friends, my countrymen, the more I weep for you. For therein is the great practical application. Strength. Strength for us. What we need is strength. Who will give us strength? There are thousands to weaken us, and of stories we've had enough. Every one of our Puranas, if you press it, gives out stories enough to fill 3/4 of the libraries of the world. Everything that can weaken us as a race we've had for the last 1,000 years. It seems as if during that period, the national life of this one end in view is how to make us weaker and weaker till we have become really earthworms, crawling at the feet of everyone who dares to put a foot on us. Therefore, my friends, as one of your blood, as one that lives and dies with you, let me tell you that we want strength, strength. And every time strength. And the Upanishads are the great mine of strength. Therein lies strength, enough to invigorate the whole world. The whole world can be vivified, made strong, energized among them, through them. They will call with trumpet voice upon the weak, the miserable and the downtrodden of all races, all creeds and all sects to stand on their feet and be free. Freedom, physical freedom, mental freedom and spiritual freedom are the watchwords of the Upanishads.